We have the holiday from hell, so you don't have to.
The Secret Tourist, next Thursday at 9 on BBC One.
Well, it goes without saying that we all love our pets and we can trust our local vet, can't we? With scenes of animals in distress, which some viewers may find upsetting, Jeremy Vine introduces a Panorama special.
Have you ever wondered who might be looking after your pet when you leave them at the vet's?
Well done. Now you're bleeding. Get him, Papa.
Tonight, we take you inside one of Britain's largest veterinary groups to reveal some of the things you don't see and your pet can't tell you.
Okay, calm down. Against the wall.
That just looked like too much distress to Yogi. So it was like a bunch of silly girls.
Sorry, but we're getting checked.
We expose vets' bills that don't add up.
I started to get suspicious, and that's the time that I thought I was being taken for a ride.
And we reveal the vet found not fit to practice. Big moment in any family's life, taking the children to choose their very first puppy.
Hello.
Hello.
You've come to see them like beautiful puppies.
They'll remember this when the children have grown up. By then, a puppy called Honey will have become a much-loved member of the family.
I've always grown up with dogs. My parents had them ever since I was born, so I'm just used to having a house where you're always greeted by somebody who's happy. She will go everywhere with us. It will be just like having a third child.
One in four homes has a pet. Their owners often make extraordinary sacrifices for them.
Come on! George.
But pets are expensive. It costs around £20,000 to keep a dog over its lifetime.
This way.
£15,000 for a cat. Busy owners pay for dog walking when they're at work, the kennels when they're on holiday.
They always make sure that they've got everything that they need when they come to stay with me. I take pictures and take them away on walks and stuff, so it's quite nice for them to see what their dog's actually doing. I can email them pictures and they often call to make sure that they're all right.
The pleasures of pet ownership are obvious, but they come with a price tag.
First time she's come off the lead. There we go.
6 weeks on, Honey is enjoying her new family. But she's already had to go to the vets. Honey's got a skin problem.
She was treated with some special stuff before she left the breeder, and then we had two trips to the vets after that just to make sure she was cleared up. And probably in excess of about £150 just for the two trips with all the treatment that she had to have as well. It is quite an expensive hobby, shall we say.
Going to the vet is increasingly expensive. Vets' bills have trebled in 10 years. But of course, there's no National Health Service for pets. Veterinary medicine is private medicine. So how do you know if you're a dog owner, like these owners here, that you're getting value for money, or that your pet is getting the high-quality treatment it deserves? Well, the answer is, you can't know. You just have to trust your vet.
There's only one way to find out what goes on behind closed doors, and that's using an undercover reporter. Alex Lee, like her father, loves animals. Now she's going to work undercover for Panorama.
I wanted to be the eyes of the public, and I wanted people to see really what goes on to their, you know, with their animals when they entrust them over to these people.
Alex has applied for a job with a leading veterinary group. Medivet are one of the largest veterinary chains in Britain. They have more than 70 branches in the southeast and are expanding into the Midlands. One in five vets in the United Kingdom is now part of a corporate chain like Medivet. Britain is famously a nation of animal lovers. We'll pay just about anything to see they're all right.
He had to go to the vet last week. It cost £150. There's a little problem to be sorted out.
If you had a son or a daughter, could you write a cheque for them, or would you sacrifice them? You wouldn't do it with the pet either. He's one of the family.
I always say there's never enough noughts to put on a cheque for him. Never.
Southend, the home of one cat lover who was shocked by how costly the new breed of vets can be. Two cats actually live here, but there are a few stray cats as well. When Dean Caddywald's favourite cat, Hoggle, became ill, there was no question. He had to go to the vet.
We noticed the cat was weeing blood, which obviously alarmed us. So we took him to Medivets over at Eastwood.
This is the local branch of the Medivet group. The vet there told Dean Caddywald he couldn't be certain what was wrong without a range of tests.
Have you got insurance, he says. I said, no, we haven't got insurance. OK. And then he still thought of some more tests that he could possibly do. Then said, do you want me to get you a quote on this? I was like, yes, please. And while he was going, I said, right, well, you know, this is going to be like £150 touch. And when he came in, it was £815.05. And I was like, wow.
Dean Caddywald left Medivet, refusing even to pay for the consultation. He took Hoggle to another local vet, who did a quick examination and suspected a common urinary infection.
He looked at him straight away. He'd done a test on him straight away. He gave us an injection, sold me 28 quid worth of food, gave us antibiotics for him, and the whole thing came to £75. That includes the 28 quid worth of food. You know, £75 versus £815.
Medivet declined to be interviewed for this programme, but they told us...
The vet was worried that the cat had been in a road accident because, Medivet say, his nails were scuffed, a very common clue. Road accidents often cause internal injuries, which can take a while to reveal themselves. This is why the vet recommended thorough assessment and tests.
Alex has got a job at Medivet. After 3 weeks on the job induction, training and assessment, she's now a trainee. New Medivet staff like Alex are described on their badge as trainee veterinary nurses, although many of them have no experience of animal healthcare. So who exactly is looking after your pet when you leave it at a vet's like Medivet? Vets are in charge and legally responsible for the treatment of animals. Supervised by the vet are qualified veterinary nurses who've studied and passed exams. Then there are student nurses on professionally recognised college courses. And trainees like Alex, who are not supposed to do any medical procedures.
Without any qualifications, I should really just be a kennel assistant. I should be feeding the animals, I should be cleaning the cages, prepping things for surgery, so putting things out, and just general tidying up and cleanliness.
There was plenty of cleaning to be done, plenty of feeding and basic care of the animals. But Alex soon found something that surprised her. Trainees like her were being allowed to carry out medical procedures. That would probably surprise most pet owners as well. Chris and Jackie Adams have owned Irish setters for years, and like many pet lovers, they organise their lives around their dogs, Crest and Yogi. They spend their holidays in the UK, so the dogs can go with them.
When you see a red setter in movement, you can see why you've got them and why you love them so much.
I just love being with them. I love their characters. We have a lot of fun together. To me, when you look at them, they make me melt.
Jackie and Chris always used a local vet where they live in Hertfordshire. When the practice was taken over by Medivet, they continued going there. First-class care was what mattered.
I would expect the person in charge of, like, Yogi or Cresty's care to be qualified as a vet. He's one of us. He's a part of the family. And it's like leaving your child with somebody who's not a registered childminder. You wouldn't do it.
Medivet promises affordable, first-class veterinary care, as well as complete peace of mind. When Yogi developed a throat problem which affected his breathing, the local Medivet surgery suggested transferring him to the Hendon Treatment Centre for further investigation. Alex was working at Hendon that day. The vet treating Yogi had telephoned instructions that a catheter be inserted into a vein in his leg in preparation for treatment. Putting in a catheter can be painful. Her colleague today has worked for Medivet for less than a year. Like Alex, she's a trainee who shouldn't be doing any medical procedures. Yogi's leg needs to be shaved to reveal a vein so the catheter can be inserted. He's already stressed. He's being held by the trainee.
I know you're stressed.
The trainee tries to show Alex how to insert the catheter.
Once you're in the vein, as you're moving it back, see you're moving the stylet out from the... It's still at sort of the point at the end, and as you're moving it down, you want to see blood. Yeah?
Right, okay.
But be confident. If you're confident, because I won't crap myself when I first did it, and it's just so...
I am crapping myself.
I know you are. It's all right. Okay, calm down. Right, okay, now you want to feel for the vein. Right, so I can feel the vein already. Can you feel it? A little go?
Yeah.
You feel it, yeah? You know where it is?
Oh, my God,
dog.
Sit. This is a nightmare.
You really keep the firm up on that leg. Calm down. Against the wall.
Yogi has breathing problems. An arm round his throat doesn't help. Alex can't insert the catheter and has given up. The trainee now tries to put the catheter in. She, too, fails. The whole episode lasted half an hour. None of the vets or qualified nurses nearby intervened. We took our undercover footage to show owners Chris and Jackie Adams.
Look at this throat. Can you hear that? Oh, look how tight, look.
There was no care there whatsoever. To me, that just looked like too much distress to Yogi. So it was like a bunch of silly girls. And that's not a veterinary practice.
Medivet isn't cheap. But I wouldn't expect trainees and people who do not know what they're doing to do that sort of thing. I was actually appalled by it.
Corrective surgery to tie back Yogi's larynx went well. It cost over £2,800. Medivet told us,
dogs often become distressed when a catheter is put into a vein. The trainee had been properly trained and had done this on many occasions without any problems.
Medivet insists that everything they allow their trainees to do is legal. They said there was no definitive list of procedures which could be carried out by trainees. It was a decision for the vet.
Veterinary surgery is regulated by the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons. It looks after animal welfare and it also handles complaints against individual vets. But the law on this is way out of date. It goes back to 1966, and one of the changes that the Royal College has been struggling to adapt to is the switch from individual practitioners to vets working for larger and larger companies.
This year, they'll begin to regulate veterinary nurses for the first time. But not trainees like Alex, because they shouldn't be doing medical procedures such as inserting catheters or giving injections.
That group of people, are they allowed to give sedative injections?
No.
Are they allowed to take blood samples?
No.
How do you stop that?
Our route of stopping that would be to act against the veterinary surgeon. If a veterinary surgeon was allowing that to take place, then we could act against that veterinary surgeon.
Early last summer, Alex was sent to work at Medivet's branch in Stanmore on the outskirts of North London. She's still just a trainee. In Stanmore, Alex worked alongside a student veterinary nurse, enrolled on a course studying for the NVQ2 exam, the first stage of qualification. There should always be a vet or qualified nurse available to supervise students when carrying out medical procedures, such as taking blood from a cat's neck.
What are you doing, from the jugular?
Yeah.
Whoops.
Alex and the student nurse are the only staff on duty.
Cool. Just put pressure on there.
The written instructions left overnight are to take blood before 9 a.m., even though the vet doesn't normally arrive till after 9.
Okay, she can go back in there for now.
There is no supervision at all. More than half an hour later, the vet who runs the practice arrives at work.
Morning.
He's Kafir Segev, a Medivet partner for 6 years and one of their most experienced vets. By law, he's responsible for the treatment of animals in his care and also for the supervision of the student nurse. The president of the Royal College hasn't seen any of our footage, but says the rules are quite clear.
Would it be okay for a student veterinary nurse to say, take blood samples before a vet arrived into the practice?
No.
So supervision means the vet has to be in the building?
I would say so, yes.
Medivet disagree, they told us.
This procedure was completely legal, normal, and was carried out at the direction of a vet. This means that the vet does not have to be present at the time.
Alex worked for Medivet for 9 months. As a floating trainee, she told me she worked wherever Medivet sent her, 15 branches in all, including three of their larger 24-hour treatment centres. Over and over again, she saw Medivet trainees carrying out medical procedures.
How dependent do you think Medivet were on trainees and people not yet in any formal training?
Very dependent. You know, the majority of their staff seem to be either trainees at college or people like myself that have just started the floating nurses. They have the 24-hour hospital branches, so you tend to have quite a few qualified nurses there. But I'd see trainees giving injections without double-checking anything. They'd see a hospital sheet that had been written up by the vet that said, you know, this amount of medication at this particular time, so they'd just get on and do it.
Medivets say they have 158 vets. 79 RCVS qualified veterinary nurses, 102 RCVS registered student nurses, and 83 veterinary nurse assistants.
Again, they insist the tasks we saw
were not illegal. The trainee veterinary nurses were properly trained and experienced. They say RCVS inspectors have never raised this as an issue, and it is common practice.
The vast majority of the medical treatment Alex witnessed at Medivet was well carried out. Here, a vet quickly and properly inserts an airway tube. It takes less than 20 seconds. And most of the Medivet branches we saw were modern and well equipped. It's important to say Alex never witnessed any cruelty. But on one occasion, an animal was roughly treated. Aaron has worked for Medivet for 5 years. He's been on student training courses, but he's not yet fully qualified as a nurse.
I'm going to enjoy stabbing you, you little bastard. Do you want to hold him? Because I don't really want to touch him.
Of course, because you've got with
him. Stanley, a Shar Pei dog, had major surgery just a few hours ago. He's had a leg amputated.
Mommy, come on.
Alex and other junior members of the team are trying to remove a catheter. Aaron comes to help. He doesn't like Sharpeys because their fur makes him itch.
Where's that fly gone?
The dog is obviously distressed. During the struggle, Alex saw something the camera missed. Aaron hitting the dog.
You could hear the performance. That's already
out. He was making so much noise and he sort of wriggled free and Aaron grabbed hold of him and he walloped him on the head. I think, come on, my jaw nearly dropped to the floor.
He can't do that.
A student nurse later reported the incident to a vet.
Both of these have just said to me that Aaron was just really manhandling that dog and just like smacked him over the head.
Yeah, we're trying to take the catheter out. You know what he's like to hold when he was flipping out and he kind of wrestled him and then.
Dog's just been in for major surgery. He's uncomfortable, he's painful. Being grabbed around like that, hit and pulled by the scruff, it's just not on. If that was my dog, I would go absolutely ballistic.
Medivets say this was an isolated incident and Aaron was warned about his behaviour. Later, in the staff room, he was apologetic.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to be so rough with that show, but he needed it, that's the thing that's going on.
Aaron has since been promoted to head nurse in another Medivet branch. Medivet told us,
striking an animal is completely unacceptable and may result in summary dismissal. Medivet disapproves of inappropriate comments about animal patients.
We wanted to get an expert opinion on our undercover material. We took it to be analysed by an experienced vet. Mike Jessop has practised for more than 20 years. He's a past president of the British Small Animal Veterinary Association.
Sadly, this is one of many examples where there doesn't seem to be experienced supervision to help these inexperienced members of staff get through some of these difficult situations.
Medivet's Kenton branch. A cat is in for a routine spay.
The weird thing is, I don't usually feel bad when I bring him in. I feel quite bad bringing this one in.
No, we'll look after her, she'll be fine.
Oh, I know.
Right, come on then, let's go and take you out the back and put you in your bed.
The vet in charge of the branch today qualified a year ago. She will first of all give the cat a pre-med injection.
Brilliant.
It's designed to calm the cat before she goes under anaesthetic.
Yep. Yeah, all done.
But it's an hour and 20 minutes before the cat is prepared for the operation.
Stop. Oh, Christ's sake.
The cat is not fully sedated. A trainee is helping the vet.
Yeah, that probably hurts. How are you doing this?
By the time they come to inducer, the anaesthetic pre-med has worn off. So she appears, from the footage I've seen, to have no sedation effect at all.
So, in other words, the primary injection was given too early?
Yes, that's right.
I don't trust you.
Working for Medivet is the young vet's first job.
I've actually pinned her down quite hard. Oh, right.
The cat is now properly restrained in the towel and the anaesthetic is given.
No. Oh, my goodness.
The cat is still conscious. Okay. It needs another dose of anaesthetic.
So we're going to draw up into another syringe, some more propofol.
Yeah,
I think.
I might need it.
Quick!
Oh, you shithead. Damn.
Well done. Now you're bleeding. Good and proper.
I'm talking to you.
Respond, please. Joe, if someone done this to my cat in the vet, I'd kill them. I know I'm not hurting her, but... Get off of him!
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness.
Can she breathe?
Yeah.
Determined.
Eventually, the cat is given a second injection of anaesthetic. Finally, it works.
That's a lot of poop for that one. I wasn't going to think I can.
She was the cat that was obviously nervous, and she was held firmly. It went from firm to severely held, and it went from severely held to silly. And that was the thing that caused me greatest concern, was to see the length of time they took over trying to get this cat asleep, and the attitude of doing it, and the fact that she was played with when she was half sedated. That, to me, was unacceptable.
Was it cruel?
Difficult to say cruel. It looks terrible. I don't think she suffered, because I don't think she was aware of anything, but the danger was that here was a cat that was in semi-anaesthesia, and what she really desperately needed was an airway tube put in place, because prolonging that time was putting her at risk.
Medivets say they
aim to give pets the highest standard of care, kindness and attention owners would expect. The vet had administered anaesthetics 200 to 300 times, so was experienced with this procedure. Timings were as recommended by the manufacturer.
Medivets say
a lightly anaesthetised animal moves and twitches involuntarily before entering deep anaesthesia. Whilst it's uncommon, it's normal, so while it may look as if the animal is distressed, it is not.
Before she can put in an airway tube, the vet first has to relax the cat's throat by spraying the larynx with local anaesthetic. But it's not done properly.
The spray used didn't seem to go anywhere near the larynx.
So now the young vet has difficulty inserting the airway tube used during the operation.
Can you get me the smaller tube, please?
What's that you got there? It's 3.5.
Yeah.
That's 3 then. I've got 2.5 just in case.
The vet is still having problems.
Oh, my goodness. This is ridiculous.
Am I holding her right? I don't really know how to...
Yeah, no, you're holding her fine. It's literally... Her larynx is so far back.
This was a young veterinary graduate who was trying to do her job but didn't seem to know what she should be doing and appeared to have no supervision to do it.
So is the upshot there then that you're trying to put this airway tube in but the throat hasn't relaxed and you can damage the cat?
Correct. That could happen.
You can direct it, like, literally you just go right into her mouth. Thank God.
The whole procedure, including the operation, took well over an hour. The cat made a full recovery.
Yeah.
Okay. Veterinary medicine is increasingly high-tech and increasingly expensive. This animal hospital is attached to the University of Liverpool. It has state-of-the-art operating theatres and CT and MRI scanners. Elsewhere in the country, there are specialist centres to treat animal cancers. The new generation of vets is taught that working up to an accurate diagnosis may involve extensive tests. More veterinary work means more costs.
We never would push clients into procedures that are unnecessary, but if people want to access the best healthcare for their pet, that's up to them. People often draw the parallel between human medicine and veterinary medicine and say, well, it's only a dog. But, of course, people spend their money on all sorts of things in our society. And I think we provide for those people.
Many graduates will go on to work for corporate veterinary chains, where the more they treat, the more they're likely to earn in commission. Despite price promotions and special offers, Medivet treatment can be costly. Alex found two clients who'd spent more than £100,000 on their pets over a 10-year period.
There we go, an actual receipt left for your credit card as well. Thank you.
But there are many satisfied clients who go back time and time again.
Mabel, Mabel.
Vivian Harris loves cats. Over the years, they've cost her many thousands of pounds at Medivet. Luckily, she has pet insurance. 3 out of 4 pet owners don't have cover.
I've never found that I've come away from Medivet feeling in any way that they've profiteered out of me, and it's been purely on a monetary basis that my animal has been treated. In the years I've known them, I would always say that at the forefront has always been the welfare of my cat.
Our undercover reporter found that one of Medivet's clients got less than a fair deal. It's the beginning of her shift at the Kenton branch.
So how are you feeling about everything?
Alex meets a new girl. She's nervous about the work and she's having a bad day. She accidentally injured the paw of a dog called Cece. Cece has a skin condition, making her easily cut. But the vet doesn't want to admit that the dog was hurt at the surgery. She instructs her trainee to phone the owner.
We'll have to say, she's opened a paddock. We just noticed it. It was done that when she walked in. It was just a bit opened. Obviously, she's caught it on something, maybe when she's been walking. It's not very deep, but it just needs a little bit of cream put on her. So they're going to manage it. So tell them, we would advise them to put some cream. If they don't want to buy it, then we can't force them.
Hello, it's Lauren calling from Medibet in Kenton. Hello, how are you?
Lauren, another trainee, makes the call.
When she came in this morning, we noticed that there was a little bit of blood coming from one of her front paws. I spoke to Ruth, and the cream that she recommends is Fusiderm. You put it onto the affected area twice a day, and that's £13.70. Are you okay for us to send one of those to you? Yeah?
No problem.
Take care. Bye.
Her hand was up pretty good.
I thought you did well.
She was reluctant.
Really?
Very reluctant. And I was like, oh, well, look, we do need to stop any infection, so otherwise it's going to get like 10 times as bad.
Well done. Thank you.
Alex went to double check with the new girl exactly what had happened.
So what happened then?
They shut the door and I hit her head trying to push her back in. But I must have caught her feet at the same time, but I didn't see her feet near the door, so somehow I think I've caught her foot. And somehow just...
Yeah, but that doesn't matter, because I grabbed it and probably made it sound like it's the level.
So she did it when she was here?
Oh, yeah, she done it when she was here.
Medivet maintained that...
The owner was not deceived. The dog's paw was bleeding because of its skin condition.
It wasn't just a pet owner Alex witnessed being misled. At the South Harrow branch, Alex spots something odd about an insurance claim.
Sorry, but with these checks...
She asks why there are three separate payouts for one case. The vet on duty explains why.
The way we did it, he came and the dog's got diabetes, and crashed and went to Hendon and was cystitis as well.
Okay.
So technically, the diabetes was the underlying cause of the cystitis. Mm-hmm. They often develop the one as a result of the other. The liver disease was most likely as a result of the diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
But what Sarah did, very cleverly, is she separated the three claims out. So we've got one for diabetes, we've got one for cystitis, and we've got one for liver.
Okay.
And what's nice about that is that he's limited to $2,400 per condition. So now that we've managed to separate it, it's given him an extra £1,000 that we can potentially claim on diabetes rather than spending all of that money on the diabetes.
Oh, okay.
So he was quite chuffed with that.
So I'll just put that.
We showed the treatment records in this case to our veterinary expert, Mike Jessop. He could see no justification for making three insurance claims.
With a diabetes case, you know that it's going to have ongoing costs, and they appear to be trying to limit the fees allocated to the diabetes at this first investigation so that there's some flexibility later on to claim more fees back.
Would the insurance company not look at it the same way as you and just say forget it?
Well, I'm particularly surprised that the insurance company didn't look at it in the same way I did and haven't raised any queries on it.
As a result of our inquiries, Tesco Insurance investigated Medivet's claims in this case and concluded that the treatment was all for one condition, which meant their claims limit had been exceeded. Medivet told us...
The insurance claims for one pet were accidentally submitted as separate claims for diabetes cystitis and a liver condition. They've apologised to Tesco and refunded the owner's insurance excess.
Medivet say they
process around 35,000 insurance claims a year and take great care to ensure all are accurate. They say whenever errors are brought to their attention, they immediately rectify them, which they did in this case.
The liver tests in this case had been dealt with by another vet at the Hendon branch and charged at over £1,000. But had they been necessary?
To be taking biopsies of the liver is quite a risky and invasive procedure, and you've got to be able to prove to yourself that the invasion and the test, the risks associated with it, outweigh the risks of the disease process. I couldn't see enough evidence to justify that degree of invasion at that stage. It was fairly obvious that the liver enzymes were raised because of the diabetes.
Medivet told us
the very experienced vet using ultrasound found a range of possible problems, including cancer and liver disease, all very serious conditions. He recommended getting a liver tissue sample. Test results were valuable because they ruled out the other serious conditions, indicating that the problems were most likely linked to Bonnie's diabetes.
Medivet run a number of larger animal treatment centres, like this one in Watford. It offers 24-hour care all year round. This centre's run by one of Medivet's senior managing partners, Guy Carter. When Alex worked there, she witnessed another example of a Medivet bill being inflated. The Watford branch was being modernised. Animals were being treated as building work went on.
At the moment we're having this reset, everything's up in the air.
In the operating theatre, two operations were going on side by side. The vet in the blue gown is the man in charge at Watford, Guy Carter. He was operating on a dog. He was also supervising the young vet who was operating on a cat, with Alex assisting throughout.
That's the large bone, the other way. Go all the way out this way, got to follow the duodenum through to the stomach. I think you're going to need a bigger hole.
Later, when the vet who treated the cat was preparing the bill, Alex witnessed another intervention from senior Medivet partner, Guy Carter.
Now, Guy was over and telling him what to add on. Blood pressure monitor, assorted materials. And I thought, oh, just hang on one second here. We didn't use a blood pressure monitor, so why are you charging for it?
I thought, well, before I jump to too many conclusions, I'd like to have a look at the bill, just to make sure, and there it was, in black and white, blood pressure monitor.
So the cat's owner was charged for the monitor?
Yes, it was.
And it was not used?
No.
Medivet told us
a blood pressure monitor was used during the operation until near the end of the procedure, when its readings became erratic. The two vets concerned discussed its use and decided a charge was appropriate.
The rolling hills of Monmouthshire on the Welsh borders. This is where vet Bob Stevenson has practiced for 40 years. He's probably the kind of person most people think of when they think of a vet. Running his own business, rooted in his community, and treating farm animals as well as pets.
Did you hear a cough, Bob?
I did hear a cough, yes. And one of them had its tongue out characteristically, almost as if they look as if they want to be sick. Husk, as they call it.
For Bob Stevenson, there is one vital ingredient in his veterinary business. Trust.
My job is only trusted as far as I am today. If I make a boob of some sort, a mistake of some sort, that is, the consequences are that the farmer loses money or animals die, then you're only as good as your last diagnosis. And tomorrow might be another day, so I'm hanging in there.
Bob Stevenson knows he can't take the trust of his community for granted, and that losing trust is one of the worst things that could happen to the veterinary profession.
Alex reports for duty at Medivet's Stanmore branch.
So welcome to Stanmore.
Yes, nice to meet you.
There's dramatic news. The Royal College has charged Kafir Segev, the branch partner, with dishonesty.
A lot of people said that they're out to get Medivet and they're trying to make an example of him. So they're trying to basically get a vet in Medivet, struck off so they can say, oi, watch it. We're watching what you're doing. They work the cases up correctly, but they jump to the extreme first rather than, you know, like if you get a lame dog, why not give it pain relief, rest, see how it goes. But instead they go x-rays, joint cytology, so they jump the gun a bit. The Medivet way is to work it up to find out why straight away. So, and people can't afford it now, really, you know.
The complaint to the Royal College was made by Andrew Button. He was the owner of a greyhound lurcher cross called Zoe.
That's just after we got her, you know, she was a baby then, just coming up to 2 years old. Very gentle dog, very kind and considerate.
In November 2006, he took the dog to Medivet in Stanmore, worried that an earlier cancer that had been treated elsewhere might have returned. He told Kafir Segev about the cancer.
Mr. Segev said there was a shoulder strain and took various x-rays and wanted the dog in for observation.
The vet asked for an immediate payment of £906. Later he asked Mr. Barton to go back and see the results of the x-rays.
He put them up on the light box and I particularly noticed this white spot and a few others. I'd been treated for cancer and it just didn't look right to me, and I specifically asked him what they were and he rather poo-pooed them and said, well, they're old scar tissue, nothing to worry about, and hurriedly took the x-ray off the light box.
It was when the vet, Kafir Segev, called with an urgent message that Mr. Barton became suspicious.
Hello?
Yeah?
He phoned me up on the Thursday of that week and said he's phoning me from home because it's his day off, but he thinks it's urgent enough to get a hold of me because he's got a slot for an MRI scan next Monday and I need to make an immediate decision, and it's going to cost £2,200. I had actually been scanned for a medical problem of my own not 6 months before, and I remember from the bills it was something like £600 and odd, and I just couldn't see how a dog scan could cost 3-4 times that amount. That's when I started to get suspicious, and that's the time that I thought I was being taken for a ride.
Looking at a likely bill of almost £5,000, Mr. Barton went back to his old vet, who treated Zoe before.
I showed him the x-rays that I'd taken from Segev, and he just looked at them and said, I'm sorry to have to tell you it's cancerous, it's spread to her lungs. Stop wasting your time and money. Your dog is going to die.
Andrew Barton complained to the Royal College, who held a hearing. Mr. Segev disputed Mr. Barton's evidence, but the disciplinary committee believed Mr. Barton, not the vet.
After a 9-day hearing here at the Royal College, the disciplinary committee's verdict on Kafir Segev's conduct was damning. They found that he lied about those x-ray results and that he deliberately concealed from Mr. Barton the true extent of his dog's terminal illness. Instead, he recommended a pointless and expensive MRI scan costing £2,200. So Kafir Segev had been dishonest, and he was found guilty of serious professional misconduct. On May the 19th last year, in this room, he was struck off.
I'm horrified that there are professional people who do this sort of thing. I put my trust in him. He's a vet. He was a qualified man, seemingly very competent. And I felt abused and hurt.
Royal College rules allowed Kafir Segev to continue to practice as a vet for 28 days while he considered an appeal. When Alex worked with him again during that period, she found him still protesting his innocence.
I am liar, I am deceiving, I am arrogant, I was lying to the committee, I was lying to the Royal College. They really went for me in every possible way to make it so watertight. And it doesn't make sense because this is not my style.
Kafir Segev had been found to have been dishonest and struck off, but he was still a partner at Medivet. As we'll see, his story was not yet over. Vets, like hospital doctors, need a regular supply of blood for emergency blood transfusions. But collecting it and selling it raises ethical dilemmas. Many owners will only volunteer their animals as donors if they're convinced it's for a good cause.
It's a little bit scary because there's so many people, but it's for the right reasons. And I wouldn't put him under anything I didn't think was right.
I think it's the potential for Billy's blood to save the lives of other critically ill dogs that's the main driving force for bringing him here.
When a company called Vets Now set up to provide emergency treatment for animals, they realised they'd need a regular supply of blood products. But they knew owners would be reluctant to allow their animals to give blood to a commercial business. So the blood bank was set up as a charity.
We felt that owners wouldn't bring their dogs in to donate if somebody was making money out of providing that blood, really. And very much felt that it should be a volunteer system, much like the human blood service.
The charity's blood is sold on to vets at cost price, around £130 each for bags of red cells and plasma. It comes with a recommendation that there is no markup when the blood is charged to the customer.
I wouldn't be prepared to bring Billy to something where there's a commercial element in it. Ethically, I always find that offended me.
I don't want anybody to profit from my animal. I don't want any company to buy the blood or sell the blood. It's only to help the animals.
Medivet don't use the charitable blood bank. They set up their own commercial company to collect and process all the blood they need. It's called Vet Blood. Alex is on the blood run, travelling to a greyhound rescue centre in the home counties.
Off you!
Rescue centres are charities which look after former racing dogs. Vet Blood examine the dogs and give them free vaccinations, some food and worming treatment if necessary. But they don't pay for the blood. The blood products are then sold to Medivet practices at a price that covers Vet Blood's collection and processing costs.
We charge £120 for a bag of plasma. It's more like a couple of hundred, £300 for them to charge to the owners.
When Medivet use the blood, pet owners are charged a markup that roughly doubles its cost. Medivet told us...
Medivet operate Vet Blood at a £16,000 annual loss. Neither Medivet nor Vet Blood make a profit on the sale of blood. Medivet subsidises these losses to provide a life-saving service. Charges are similar to those of the very few other providers of blood.
In a little over 20 years, the Medivet partnership has grown from just a couple of branches to 75. How much each branch partner makes isn't known. The controlling company had a turnover of over £20 million last year. The managing partner is Arnold Levy. He spends most of his time running the business from Medivet's headquarters in Watford. But he still likes to keep his hand in as a vet.
Just crash.
Blood products are not used very often, but when they are, it is usually an emergency. A Labrador dog had collapsed and was brought into the Hendon clinic, critically ill with internal bleeding.
I think we just give the blood and the plasma now. We'll put one in each leg.
The plasma was never used, but the dog urgently needed blood before they could operate. It's a bank holiday, and managing partner Arnold Levy is helping out.
Arnold, I think he's just going to crash on us in a minute. His eyes just remain open now.
Despite intense efforts to save it, the dog died.
Oh, excuse me.
Oh, shit, isn't it?
Especially when you've been, like, looking after him, do you know what I mean?
It's horrible to watch him die like that. That's the first time it's ever died on me.
Medivet's bill for trying to save the dog's life was £850. This included £235 for a bag of red blood cells and a further £112 for administering it, making £347 in all for the blood transfusion. One of the trainees wondered what to do with the bag of blood used to try to save the dying dog, used but still almost half full. She asked the man in charge, Arnold Levy.
You just bung the end of this.
Get this back inside you.
What we are seeing is the draining of the blood back into the blood bag. Now, this is material that should be binned, and yet we're seeing it prepared back for reuse.
Alex didn't see another animal treated with the blood. But instructions were given to put it back in the fridge where it would have been available for reuse.
Do you go back in the freezer then? Oh, you... OK. But it doesn't matter that it's been out and been... No.
Not just in the fridge.
Okay.
Thank you.
When Alex checked the fridge more than 2 weeks later, the opened bag of blood was still there. Medivet told us...
While Medivet normally discard and use blood immediately, there was only a small amount left in stock, so Mr. Levy decided to return the blood to the bag hygienically to keep it overnight for any emergencies. So it was resealed and refrigerated, but never used and later discarded.
The deadline for an appeal by vet Kafir Segev against being struck off for disgraceful professional conduct has passed. Despite his earlier confidence, Kafir has not appealed. He's one of only five vets struck off or suspended by the RCVS last year.
Good morning. How are you doing?
Welcome, welcome.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
Even though found guilty of dishonesty, he continues to run the veterinary practice, no longer as a vet, but now as the practice manager. Kafir Segev's name was still above the front door. The letters MRCVS, member of the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons, have simply been taped over. Kafir Segev had taken on a new vet to carry out medical procedures for him. But he still gave his opinion on how treatment should be carried out.
And if you distribute your sutures, like if this is the... cartilage and
skin. So you can be a vet who struck off and you can run a veterinary practice and that's fine.
I'm not saying it's fine. We do not have jurisdiction over that.
You're powerless to stop this.
We're powerless to prevent a non-vet being a manager of a veterinary company, just as
Doesn't that strike you as a bit amazing?
He is a layperson like any other, and it may not be a desirable situation, and I might agree with you totally, but we don't have jurisdiction at the minute, no.
Kafir Segev was an experienced vet. We'd seen him handle difficult animals like this cat needing an injection. Under Royal College rules, he's now eligible to reapply to practice as a vet. Yet even before he was struck off, we'd seen Kafir Segev repeatedly breaching professional standards. One area of veterinary medicine is particularly tightly regulated, administering anaesthesia. That's because of the dangers involved.
Maybe do you want to put a bit more in? Because he's still a bit... Yeah.
Giving an increasing dose of anaesthetic until it takes effect is so risky, it can only be done by a vet. Yet on three separate occasions, Alex witnessed Kafir Segev allowing a student nurse to anaesthetise animals this way.
Anaesthesia can be called controlled death. You are so close to losing that animal if you're not being very, very careful.
The vet Kafir Segev checks what's happening only once for a few seconds. He allows the student nurse to carry on giving the dog a dental clean.
His jaw's getting a bit tight, he's fighting it back. Yeah. What
are you on?
One and a half.
Turn him up to 2.5 to get him down. So I think he's a bit
Whilst a second vet is on the phone, the head nurse advises increasing the level of anaesthetic gas. This is an instruction which should only be given by a vet. As a result of turning the animal over, the tube delivering the air and gas has started to work its way out of the dog's throat.
It just came out anyway.
That's putting that animal at risk. And it's the very reason that the Royal College has this stipulation of not allowing inexperienced and non-qualified staff from performing these very, very risky procedures.
Which is it?
Yeah, it's not in any way.
The procedure is finished.
There you go, it's better, isn't it?
Later, after we told Medivet what Alex had witnessed, Kafir Segev resigned. Medivet said,
Medivet considers Mr. Segev's conduct a clear breach of the profession's code and is extremely disappointed by his actions. Medivet has reported these matters to the RCVS. Although the animals operated on were not harmed or injured in any way, Medivet apologises for this breach. The conduct of this one vet does not represent the professionalism and excellence of Medivet's vets and staff, and the service provided to its clients and their animals.
I only worked for Medivet, and I was there for several months, but I was surprised at the level of responsibility that I was given, considering I've got no experience, no background in animal care. I'm sure pet owners will feel the same.
Throughout our dealings with Medivet, they've insisted their standards are as high or higher than the rest of the veterinary profession. It will be up to the Royal College to decide if those standards need to be enforced more rigorously.
David Dimbleby has more on tonight's Question Time in just a moment. But next on BBC One, the latest BBC News.
Rupert Everett is on the trail of his rebellious great-grandfather.
He had tattoos. Tremendous. So he really was a proper old sailor.
He came from aristocracy.
I wonder what happened that he rebelled so much.
I like naughty boys.
I like naughty boys too.
Who do you think you are? Monday at 9 on BBC One.
The last Question Time of the summer tonight, as the coalition government reaches the end of its first parliamentary term. Damien Green, the Immigration Minister, will be here, Bob Crowe of the RMT Union, Nigel Farage from UKIP, Sadiq Khan from the Shadow Cabinet, and the economist Ruth Lee. Join us for a last shout, 10:35 after the news.
And at 10 o'clock, the BBC News now on BBC One with George Alagaya and Mike Ramsden.
No charges in the case of the bystander at the G20 protests who died after being pushed to the ground by a police officer. This was the moment Ian Tomlinson was shoved over. Minutes later, he was dead. Doctors disagreed on what caused his death. His family say there's been a cover-up.
Words can't describe how we feel. We feel very let down, very disappointed. You know, we're just the other people that have been bumped off and another cop has been let off.
We'll be looking at where the family's campaign for justice goes from here. Also tonight, all dressed up and nowhere to go, Buckingham Palace withdraws its garden party invitation to the BNP leader, Nick Griffin.
I think it's deeply shocking. I'm there with the backing of a million British voters with a mandate to go speak on their behalf, and I'm not allowed at the last minute.
The cap stays on BP's well for now amid warnings of tropical storms about to hit the Gulf of Mexico.
Has he got it? Yes, he has.
And spinning his way into the record books, the Sri Lankan bowler Murali makes history with his last ball in Test cricket.
On BBC London News, claims of a broken Olympic promise. Just what's happened to the thousands of local jobs? And caught on camera, the locksmith guilty of defrauding customers.
Good evening. A police officer who pushed a bystander to the ground during last year's G20 demonstrations will not face charges over the man's death. Ian Tomlinson died minutes after the incident. The Crown Prosecution Service, which has been looking at the case, said there was no realistic prospect of a conviction against the officer after medical experts disagreed about the cause of death. Mr. Tomlinson's family called the decision outrageous and said there'd been a cover-up. Our Home Affairs correspondent June Kelly reports.
Ian Tomlinson was not involved in the G20 protests. He was on his way home to watch the football. His final journey captured by an American tourist. He has his back to the policeman who pushes him from behind. This is what sparked a criminal investigation. The officer is Constable Simon Harwood of the Met Police's Territorial Support Group. Ian Tomlinson got up, but shortly afterwards collapsed and died close by. Now, 16 months on, finally an announcement from the Crown Prosecution Service.
After a thorough and careful review of the evidence, the CPS has decided that there is no realistic prospect of a conviction against the police officer in question.
Ian Tomlinson's family had been told the news a few minutes before. They were stunned.
The CPS are clearly admitting that the police officer assaulted their dad. Why has there been no charge? We have to go home now to know dad.
It seems to be so much harder when you go up against a police officer, you know. When you're going up against the old Bill, you're fighting too much of a losing battle. Everyone favoured him from the outset.
For a manslaughter charge to be brought, there would have to be proof of a link between the policeman's push and Ian Tomlinson's death, say prosecutors. And this is where the medical experts were split. On the 3rd of April last year, a first post-mortem shortly after Ian Tomlinson's death